Thank you very much. Good morning, Yuma. Welcome to the State of the City. I appreciate the Chamber of Commerce. We do have these great slides on the side. And I'd also like to thank Yuma Investment Group. This is the third year in a row that they've sponsored the State of the City, and I appreciate that level of support. So let's give both organizations a round of applause. I'd also like to recognize these folks in this picture. I call them the five-year council because they all signed up for 4 years and then the state magically added a fifth year to their term. So I'd like to really give a round of applause to everyone on council that we work great together year over year. So in the State of the City, I believe we really have to celebrate the great things that happen, but we also need to talk about some of the maybe not so great things. So we're going to start off with the not so great. We'll move to the great things as we get through the presentation. So unfortunately, we're going to talk about COVID really quick. And the community's fight against COVID. So as a city, we don't have a health department. We don't have doctors on staff. We don't have medical professionals. But we're able to make some positive impacts during the pandemic. We participated with the state in Yuma County for the vaccination pod that was at the Civic Center. 8,000 doses was the capacity every week that we could push through that pod. It was one of the highest level producing pods the state was involved with. We also created the Adopt a Nurse program, which was to support our men and women in the healthcare industry. Those particularly at YRMC, the Civic Center, Regional Center for Border Health, Sunset Community Health, and the Yuma County Health Department. They have been beat up for the last 2 years, overworked, and just kind of at their wit's end. And so the Adopt a Nurse program was to provide a little bit of reinforcement from the community. To try to put together a party during the pandemic wasn't going to happen, right? So this was a way that we could show support. We raised over $10,000, provided over 3,000 lunches, and thousands of energy drinks and sodas and coffee. We also did some pretty innovative things during the pandemic that led the state. We did the wastewater testing program. Yuma Center of Excellence for Desert Agriculture led the program with support from Yuma County, from the state of Arizona, and from the city staff. This was a program that let us understand where the hot spots were happening as they were happening by testing the wastewater. The city staff, our water and sewer folks were able to help achieve the testing or get to the testing locations. As you can imagine, that's probably not an easy thing to do, popping sewer manholes and taking samples. And then we were able to understand where things were going as a community. We also did an extension of premises. It's kind of a term that we let our businesses, particularly anywhere there where they fronted right-of-way or parking lots, extend their businesses out into that outdoor area. What that did was provide, one, an outdoor space, which all the pandemic recommendations were to be outdoors, but also let them have more space to operate in. And so that was, here in Yuma, one of the things that we worked with the governor's office, and they ended up implementing it statewide, but not before Yuma implemented it here locally, and worked with the liquor department to extend liquor licenses out in the curbs. That has worked so well, the city council made it permanent this last year. The next discussion is the border. So we've had, again, a strong uptick on the number of people crossing the international border. Last fiscal year, so this goes before this last year, the federal fiscal year starts in October, there were 148,000 people interdicted by Border Patrol that came across the border, 148,000. This fiscal year, to this date, we're 5 months into this new fiscal year, we've already crossed that mark. We're over 148,000. So the situation's not getting any better. What is getting better is our local Border Patrol. They've increased capacity, and they're able to handle the flow of people coming through the border to prevent any sort of impact into our community. And so that's really kind of where we were in December. In December, we had in a three-day period over 6,000 people come across the border at once. That surge created an unsustainable situation within the Border Patrol system, and people were not able to be interdicted in a timely manner. So what people did, they started moving through the community, and they're looking for resources, and they're looking for the Border Patrol station. They end up at the fire station. They end up in different locations. And this didn't seem like a sustainable way to address immigration in our community. So I declared a proclamation of emergency, and that did two things for us. It created a lot of awareness nationally and locally, and brought in quite a bit of attention, which is really the only thing we can do. Immigration issues are not, just to be clear, because I get this question all the time, city council cannot affect immigration. It has to be the federal government. So having that attention was important. But then also it opened up the ability for FEMA reimbursement for some of our nonprofits, as well as just bringing in some more of the local support for things happening locally. So that proclamation is still in place, and until the situation and the numbers start to drop, I'm going to leave it in place just so that we have that as a resource. Thankfully, our Border Patrol has done a great job, and the men and women there do a great job making sure that our community is protected as we move forward and prevent any sort of humanitarian crisis that could develop by that many people coming through all at one time. All right. We are on to some of the good stuff. In 2020, Council adopted a strategic plan. And in 21, we updated the plan. That's something we're going to be doing every year to make sure that we're seeing what we've accomplished and looking at what do we need to change as we move forward. Here's the plan. Actually, that's just a depiction of the plan. This came from the work session we did as a council with the consultant, and they drew that as we were talking, and it was kind of impressive. That's why we keep using it, because it reminds us of that. But it's kind of hard to read, so I'll read the five strategic outcomes. Safe and prosperous, connected and engaged, active and appealing, unique and creative, and respected and responsible. Those are maybe nebulous terms that could mean something different to everybody, and that's on intention. We do need it to mean something different to everybody so that we can represent the full community. Instead of being hyper-specific on the outcomes, what we focus on being hyper-specific, are on the very specific details of implementation. And we'll get some examples of what that looks like. So our parks is one of the key elements of the strategic plan. It falls into safe and prosperous, connected and engaged, active and appealing, and unique and creative. Almost every strategic outcome is somehow wrapped up in our parks program. So we've had some very specific and aggressive park up. Is everything okay in there? None of this should be surprising to anybody. So. The Joe Henry Optimist Center, we tore out the old basketball courts, brought in new basketball courts, they poured new concrete, and added some pickleball courts. And in the gym, we put in air conditioning and a new flooring. So that whole area is revitalized here in the Mesa Heights Revitalization District. The Caballero Playground, we will be replacing and are in the process of replacing some of the Ramadas, some of the playground equipment, picnic tables. On the Castle Park, after we had that fire and we rebuilt that, the flooring didn't operate as well as it had on the original installation and started to crumble. So we're getting that ripped out and in the process of getting that replaced. The Kennedy Skate Park was in a very aggressive public engagement effort. We had over 100 people show up to the public meeting and thousands of inputs online on what that park should look like. And so we are currently have develop the plan, the general plan on how that's going to look. It's going to revitalize kind of the elements and modernize the elements of the skate park and answer the question to our youth of that there's nothing to do in Yuma. So we're going to help provide to them as a community a great skate park that's top of the line and I heard could be a competitive arena at some point. So that's underway, and we look to see some development this next year, as well as the East Mesa Park. Again, this is a big need we hear from our community, that as the community grows to the east, to the 60, 70, 80 area, the park facilities are all in the kind of original footprint of the community. So how are we going to serve our families and our community members on the east side? So the East Mesa Park is a... is that beginning of that answer. So this park, again, went through a very exhaustive public input process. Hundreds of people, thousands of inputs into what this park should look like. More information as that comes out and gets finalized. But again, it'll be an early action item that we look to try to get this park installed and up and operating for our community. If you have a philanthropic group that wants to do a project, let us know. We've got the ability to do quite a bit in that park. We also have had several other park improvements. The River Trail expansion will connect the Gateway Park and West Wetlands with a 4,000-foot-long trail. So that's underway. The Yuma Valley Area Park, a rehabilitation we just are getting started here this next month. That's where we're going to improve the playing surface. This is for our soccer community primarily. There's a huge need for more soccer fields, and so the park needed a better surface, a better playing surface, and so we're in the process of making that happen right now. On the playground replacements, we did an inventory of all the different elements within the parks in Yuma. Came up with a hit list of things we needed to get addressed, and we're working through that on nearly a daily basis to improve those. The Gateway Beachfront Park is about beaches that don't normally exist. When you put sand in a place, magically the sand eventually goes away. So as the river flows, it takes that sand away. So we're replenishing that sand and just doing some improvements with the beach park, as well as improving some of the parking lots associated with some of our parks. This last year, we were on ESPN, believe it or not, in partnership with Arizona Western College and the Caballeros de Yuma. We did compete on a national level for the women's NJCAA softball championship, the national championship. That we were successful in that partnership to bring that championship here to Yuma for last year and this year. That brought in 16 teams, did put us on the programming for ESPN, and all reports have been that those 16 teams had a great time. So not it wasn't just those team members, it was the coaches and the families and all those that came here during the pandemic, helped support of our community, and they were in an outside venue, so we were making sure everyone was had the opportunity to be safe, but had a great tournament, and we're going to do it again next year, or this year, it's coming up, and so we have a two-year stint, and then it goes to, I think, Alabama for 2 years, but then we'll be back at it looking to bring it back in. But this is an example of the capability of the Pacific Avenue Athletic Complex. The complex this last year, just to give you an update, besides the national tournament, held 30 other tournaments from the region. So we had people far away from Chicago and Hawaii coming here for those tournaments. Hosted 7 softball leagues, also hosted archery, soccer, and fishing, as well as it's the host or the home for our fallen law officer memorial. So there's a lot happening at the PAC. So stop by and see what's going on there just about every weekend. We are on to some highlights, really kind of focusing on finance and grants. One of the early strategic initiatives that we focused on as a council was solving our public safety personnel retirement system deficiency. We made a promise to our men and women in blue that they would have a retirement system that was very, very specific for their willingness to put themselves out on the front line and protect our community. This was one of the things that we promised our men and women. Well, as the system ran for the first two tiers of employees, law enforcement, it was actually not funded correctly, and this is a statewide issue. We were underfunded by $140,000 a year. As that accumulated at 7.3% interest, it created a dramatic unfunded liability that we would just have to pay out of the city budget every year. So what we did is we took advantage of the really low interest rates. Anyone else refinance their house lately? We, as a council, decided that that's what how we wanted to address this. By going out and bonding and paying that unfunded liability today through a bond proceeds, we saved the taxpayers $73 million over the next 20 years. And that's at a 2.3% interest rate, which I think is a good rate. We'll ask our financial people, is that a good decision? Okay. So building upon the success of that bond sale, we knew that we were going to be in a spot on the east side again with our sewer system that it was starting to reach capacity. It was originally designed to be expanded, so we were prepared for this looking forward. However, it cost money to expand it. So we went back out for bonds, for utility obligation bonds, for the $71 million that it takes to expand that plant. That'll bring in 3.3 million gallons of capacity, not just for our homes in the East Valley, but for industry and commercial, which is really where the economic drivers happen for our community. So we were very successful again, got even a lower rate at 2.26, and that'll help us fund our growth and actually encourage our growth here in our community moving forward. We were very successful this year on federal grants, which is great to get some of those federal dollars flowing back this way. The Yuma Multimodal Transportation Center is the Del Sol, the Hotel Del Sol on Gila Street. For years, this has been identified as a transportation hub, but also an opportunity for some public-private investment to help reinvigorate and build upon the momentum that we have going on in downtown. For the 9 years I've been in office, I've been going to Washington, D.C. to advocate for a federal grant. It's currently called the RAISE. It's been called the TIGER. It's been called the BUILD. It happens with every administration. They got to twist around all the acronyms. But before those 9 years, there's been probably another 10, 15 years of people advocating and working forward towards this program. So this year was the year. We were awarded a $10.6 million RAISE grant for the rehabilitation of the Hotel Del Sol. We are currently wrapping up the early design of the reconstruction of the building with a previous grant that we had received, a much smaller grant, but that's important that we're utilizing our federal dollars. And then we'll be looking for a public-private partner to help us build out the rest of it. So the Transportation Modal, Multimodal Center, which includes Greyhound, YCAT, all of our, Amtrak, which is right across the street, which is why this is the important location for the Multimodal Center. They'll be all located on the ground floor. And then the rest of the structure is open for public or private investment. It could be housing, could be commercial, could be office, could be educational. There's a lot of opportunities available, but the bones by the end of this $10.6 million RAISE grant, the bones of the building will be good. It's just filling in the ultimate use. So that was a successful, and I don't mind going to DC to advocate for things, but when you talk about it 9 years in a row, it gets old. So I'm glad that we're moving forward on this one. We also were able to bring in a $600,000 grant from the EPA for the brownfield analysis. So brownfield are areas where had city infrastructure in it, It's fallen to disuse and disrepair and needs to be reinvigorated. So this is for the area south of Gist Parkway. Used to be where the Union Pacific Railroad had their maintenance yard. This grant will make sure that we've got some, it's actually called the Old Town South. And we worked with Yuma County in the Yuma Crossing National Heritage Area, and we'll be making sure this area is clean environmentally and ready for development. We're also moving forward on the Yuma Spaceport through a grant that we got through EDA to go through the feasibility study. Amazingly, we are apparently the only place in the state of Arizona that can safely launch a rocket into space. Interestingly enough, the site that we have purchased as a city on Avenue B and County 23rd Street is the right location to launch, because within a few seconds, you're up over the Gulf of California, and that allows for the safety zone should a rocket not quite make it to space. We're not talking Elon Musk jumping on the top of a rocket and going up. We're talking commercial commsats, communication satellites. The space industry has really grown over the last 10 years, and the backlog of that work is important, is really backed up. And so we believe that we can provide that element of the industry here in the Yuma area, working closely with the Marine Corps Air Station and the airspace constraints that we have here in order to make that possible. So we're now currently working with the governor's office on the next step, which is the application to the FAA and getting our permit to operate. So look forward to that as that moves forward. All right, the economy. This is where the rubber meets the road, right? So again, starting off a little bit of bad news. Prior to the pandemic, we in the city of Yuma, we had over 43,000 jobs in the city. At the worst part of the pandemic, we lost over 6,000 jobs. And that only took us from March to June. So that was pretty quick. But I'm proud to report, not only have we recovered those jobs, but we have added 2,200 more jobs to our economy. And so let's talk about some projects, some investments into our community. We broke ground with the La Quinta Inn and Suites by Wyndham. This is adjacent to the PAC. It'll add 83 rooms to the hotel mix here in our community. I believe, I've not been able to fully confirm that, but this is, I believe, the only hotel that broke ground in the middle of the pandemic in the state of Arizona. That's a testament to how strong our hotel industry is here in our community. Because a few months later, we then cut the ribbon on the Four Points Sheraton. That added 110 rooms and some great convention space. The Arizona State Veterans Home should be opening this June. That'll offer 80 veterans the opportunity to live in an assisted care, including a whole wing dedicated to memory care for our men and women who have served our country. And if you're... And if you're in the medical field, they are hiring today and need to fill out that facility in preparation for June. This was a partnership with the city of Yuma. We provided the land. The state and the federal government provided 50% each of the funding of getting this constructed. So it was a great vision by our council to make sure that we supported those elements to participate at the state and federal level. We also, let me back up. Are anticipating the opening of the Exceptional Healthcare Hospital out on Araby Road in the interstate, and the Thomas F. Ault Utilities Complex should be open this spring. That is the new home for our utilities group within the city, named after Mayor Ault, who was the mayor at the time the utilities were actually brought into the city of Yuma. We also have had an amazing year overall in construction. We've had a 5% increase from last year, and we're on mark for another about 5 to 6% increase this year. We've had a 20% increase in our commercial construction permits, with a total investment last year of $161 million in construction in the Yuma community. And we're on to our community engagements or community involvement. And this really focuses on the how do we communicate outside of our community, so at the state level and the federal level and even the international level. So this year I was appointed by the president to the Environmental Protection Agency's Local Government Advisory Committee. What that does is it brings attention to what EPA regulations do to local communities. There's about 35 mayors and supervisor county officials in this group, and the idea is instead of it all being top down, we're actually trying to influence the policies within EPA. We've got a few EPA issues we need to get addressed, and so this is extremely important, not just to the city and not just to our local community, but to the whole state of Arizona. I'm also the vice president of the League of Cities and Arizona Cities and Towns. This is the advocacy group that works with our state legislature. So again, the perspective of what's happening at local government, the government closest to the people, and how it's impacted by the state legislature and their bills. And we've got actually Rodney Short here with our city attorney's office spends an inordinate amount of time engaging our state legislature on our behalf, working with the league in that role. On the Arizona Commerce Authority, I've been appointed to the Rural Business Development Advisory Council, which again is about making sure that the Yuma perspective is heard within the ACA. Forefront ED has been our international face, really, for the region. NASR's done a great job of pivoting. Usually we attend conferences and give presentations. Well, what he's worked on is pivoting to an online presence. And he has done dozens of online presentations with different experts throughout the region. So we might be talking power one time and water the other. We have tourism to economic development to education. Hundreds of people each time from across the country tune into these broadcasts online, and just had a great way of continue to represent our community during the pandemic. And then we were able to have the fifth mayor's bike ride, mayors being plural, not possessive, where we were able to, again, go from the city of Yuma through the Cocopah Reservation, through Somerton, Gadsden, San Luis, and end up in San Luis, Rio, Colorado. We skipped a year, but we had 200 people show up for this event this year and look to build upon that again as we move forward. And I'm going to wrap it with this picture. I'd like to really thank these people in this picture. This is my family. They put up with a lot from phone calls at different times of the day and distractions when we're out just even grocery shopping. But without them, I couldn't do, nor would I want to do what I do. So with that, here's my contact information. If you ever want to need to get a hold of me, want to get a hold of me, want to have a discussion on anything, we're there for you. Our council's there for you. And with that, I will end. Thank you very much.